In my last video, The History of the Guitar, 1970 to 79, many of you noticed that I didn't include any fusion players. There's a very short clip of John McLaughlin in the very beginning that was untitled, but I really didn't touch on any of the fusion players. I didn't say anything about him, about Al Di Meola, about Larry Carlton, about Dean Parks, about Elliot Randall, about Denny Diaz, about Skunk Baxter, about Jay Graydon, about Steve Lukather. I didn't talk about Eric Johnson. I didn't talk about Robin Ford either. As a matter of fact, I didn't talk about Jerry Garcia, and I only talked a little bit about Alan Holdsworth. This video, I want to focus on some of the guitar players that I left off of that video. And the reason that I left them off is because they are what I call fusion guitarists. I don't mean fusion in the traditional sense of the word, that is jazz and rock being blended together. It is the case for some of them, but for some people, it's blending other styles. For example, Steve Morris that blends country guitar with jazz or with rock. Or Jerry Garcia that blends bluegrass and blues with rock. Or Larry Carlton that blends rock, blues, and jazz together seamlessly. When I went into the 70s rock guitar segment, many of you noticed how similar a lot of the clips were to each other. Basically, because most of the guys are blues-based guitar players. I mean, there's not as huge of a difference between Jimmy Page and Eric Clapton and Duane Allman as there is between Alan Holdsworth and Jimmy Page. They are worlds apart. So what I want to focus on today are the people that were the real innovators and different from everyone else. I'd like to begin with John McLaughlin, or Mahavishnu John McLaughlin. Most people became familiar with his work in the late 60s through the records he did with Miles Davis, In a Silent Way, Bitches Brew, Jack Johnson, and On the Corner. In the early 70s, he formed the Mahavishnu Orchestra, which was a blend of jazz, rock, and Indian music. Let's check it out. If that doesn't get your attention, I don't know what will. That was the great Billy Cobham on the drums with John McLaughlin on the guitar. These videos are available on YouTube. You can watch them and you should watch them. That's why I didn't lump them in with the rest of the rock players, because this is something different. This was something new and experimental at the time. If you know about John McLaughlin, chances are you'll know about the next guitarist we're going to be talking about, which is Al Di Meola. Al got his start when he was 19 years old in 1974 with Chick Corea's Return to Forever. In 1977, Al released a record called Elegant Gypsy that featured a song called Mediterranean Sundance. Al invited a guitarist that he had seen play in Spain, Paco de Lucia, to play on this with them. This introduced Paco to a worldwide audience. Check out this clip of Paco playing with a bunch of friends sitting around him. You can actually see all three players play in this next clip: Al Di Meola, Paco de Lucia, and John McLaughlin. Next, I'd like to talk about English guitarist Alan Holdsworth. Alan Holdsworth is cited by more guitarists in more different genres, rock, metal, and jazz, than anyone I can think of. From Eddie Van Halen to Joe Satriani to Steve Vai, Greg Howe, Sean Lane, Richie Kotzen, Alex Lifeson, Yngwie Malmsteen, Ty Tabor, Kurt Rosenwinkel, John Petrucci, Tom Morello, to Robin Ford, who called him the John Coltrane of the guitar. Alan's playing incorporated a vast amount of harmonic, melodic, and rhythmic concepts, improvising over incredibly sophisticated and harmonically complex chord progressions. Alan employed a dizzying amount of techniques using diminished scales, augmented scales, whole tone scales, harmonic major scales, creating this unpredictable inside and outside style playing. In the mid-70s, Alan played with a number of different groups: Soft Machine, the new Tony Williams, Lifetime, and in 1978 joined the group UK for their debut record, which featured the song In the Dead of Night, which has one of the greatest progressive rock solos of all time. The UK record also features the tune Nevermore, which is one of the few times you can hear Holdsworth playing on acoustic guitar. Some of the most influential guitar work of the 1970s and all time happened on one group's series of records. That group was Steely Dan. Their debut record, Can't Buy a Thrill, released in November of 1972, featured two hit singles that had legendary guitar solos. One of them was Elliot Randall's solo on Reelin' in the Years. The other is Denny Diaz's choral electric sitar solo on Do It Again. Check it out. This is really smoking. He's basically playing it in G Dorian, and he has that flat five in there for a G minor blues scale. There's one lick in here that I really love, and it's kind of indicative of the soul, this thing. Here it is solo, listen. He's using the G minor blues scale like this. He's gone. Great use of chromaticism in that, in the G minor pentatonic scale, G minor blues scale. It's awesome, especially on the electric sitar. On Steely Dan's Royal Scam record released in 1976, LA session guitarist Larry Carlton played two of the greatest guitar solos of all time. One of them was Kid Charlemagne. Other was Don't Take Me Alive. Another killer Steely Dan solo is from the tune My Old School, which is from the Countdown to Ecstasy record released in 1973. It's played by Jeff Skunk Baxter, who was actually in Steely Dan and then later in the Doobie Brothers. So two huge, huge bands he was in. Here's the solo. Comes in here. I'm going to do a video on this. Great tone. So there's a number of solos. The next solo comes in here, and they're all incredibly rhythmic. Another song with great guitar solos is played by none other than Walter Becker from Steely Dan. The song Black Friday has a couple incredible solos. He's actually playing on, I think I read this, Denny Diaz's Telecaster. Here's a second solo. Great tone, great feel, great playing. The iconic guitar solo from the song Peg was played by the great Jay Graydon. This one. This is an insane solo. Love it. Right here. Then Steve Lukather is one of the top session guitarists of all time. His playing is incredibly diverse and has played on over 1,500 albums, spanning from Aretha Franklin to Lionel Richie to Michael Jackson to his band Toto. Here he is playing with Toto in 1979. Another guitarist that combines elements of blues, jazz, and rock is Robin Ford. Robin was a member of both the LA Express and the Yellow Jackets. Here's a clip of him playing in 1979 with the LA Express. Another guitarist that combines the genres of rock and jazz is guitarist Larry Coryell, who can be seen in this clip playing with Gary Burton's quintet. The next guitarist went on to achieve iconic status in the 1980s. Here he is performing with his group in 1975, the Electromagnets, Eric Johnson. The next guitarist many of you probably have never heard of, his name is Carlos Rios. He's an LA session guitarist that played on the Gino Vannelli Brother to Brother record. That's where I first heard him. As a matter of fact, on the tune Brother to Brother, he plays an incredible solo. Check this out. Steve Morris is a guitarist that can do anything. His band, the Dixie Drags, began in the 70s and was an eclectic mix of hard rock, southern rock, and progressive metal. Here's a clip of him playing with the Drags in 1978. Some of you know the name Lenny Bro. Lenny Bro was one of the most eclectic guitarists from the 50s through 1984 when he died tragically at the age of 43. His parents were country and western musicians, so he grew up with the tradition of that type of music and then developed a love for jazz. His harmonic concept combined country music, classical music, modal music, Indian music, jazz, and just about everything else. Because of being a fingerstyle player, he approached the guitar like a piano. You can see that in this clip of him playing Stella by Starlight. Danny Gatton was another guitarist that died tragically in his 40s. His style playing fused blues, rockabilly, jazz, and country to create a musical style called redneck jazz. If you use the word legendary for anyone, it fits our next guitarist, who is Jerry Garcia. Jerry was a singer, songwriter, and lead guitarist of the Grateful Dead, but played on countless side projects. His music and the Grateful Dead's music influenced people from John Mayer to Bruce Hornsby to Fish and thousands of bands in between. His influence on 20th century music and culture is almost impossible to quantify. Our last guitarist put out his first solo record in 1975, called Bright Size Life, which featured Jaco Pastorius on the bass. Although his career started in the mid-70s, it has continued till today. Pat Metheny's style is a combination of everything from jazz and bebop to country to modern classical music to rock. Here's a clip of him playing with the Pat Metheny Group in 1979. That's all for now. Please subscribe here to my Everything Music YouTube channel. If you're interested in the Beato book, go to my website at www.rickbeato.com. And remember, you can support this channel through the Beato Club. Go to my website and check it out. Thanks for watching.